This is the June 27th meeting of the Conway Selectboard. We're being recorded by Frontier Community Access Television for viewing by members of the community who cannot make the meeting tonight. Okay, first item on the agenda, minutes for the June 13th meeting. Has everybody reviewed the minutes? Any changes or additions to the minutes? No?
All good.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes for the June 13th meeting. Do I have a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Any discussion? No? Okay. Next item on the agenda, we have four warrants tonight. We have a vendor warrant for fiscal 2016 of $53,749. We have a vendor warrant for fiscal 2017 for $53,910. We have a payroll warrant for $101,756 and a payroll deduction warrant of $22,433. I'll make a motion that we approve those warrants.
Second.
Do I have a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, any discussion? No? Okay. Meetings attended by select board members since our last meeting?
I went to an NCAP meeting, and okay. It was the first NCAP meeting since I joined the board.
Okay.
So mainly NCAP is trying to decide what they want to do from here. You know, they still represent towns that are against the pipeline, but now the pipeline's sort of perhaps ended. And
Could you explain to our viewers what MCAP
the Municipal Coalition Against the Pipeline.
Okay.
And perhaps now they're thinking of it as meaning the Municipal Coalition Against Pipelines and perhaps supporting some of the other towns that still have pipelines. For example, out in Sandusfield, Kinder Morgan wants to run a pipeline through the out-of-state forest. And that's the one that is having a set of hearings, and Kinder Morgan won the first hearing out in Pittsfield, and Maura Healy is trying to decide whether the state's going to appeal that or not. Mm-hmm. And they may or it may not. It's not clear.
Okay. Okay. Any other meetings? No. Okay. Thank you. Any citizens' concerns? We have any citizens' concerns? No. Okay. We don't have any old business. First item on the new business agenda is FERCOG, Mohawk Trail, Woodlands Partnership presentation and discussion. Peggy and Bob, you guys are up.
All right. Well, thank you for having us. We wanted to come and give you an update on the project, answer any questions that you might have, and also talk with you about special legislation that we've been working on with some of our delegation. So just by way of background, if you're not familiar with the project, it covers 11 Franklin County towns and 10 Berkshire County towns, so mostly West County and Franklin County. And it started out as a forest conservation project, but it really has shifted. And there's three goals. One is natural resource-based economic development. The second is forest conservation. And then the third is municipal financial sustainability. When we started off the project, we did a couple of regional meetings, and then we visited, at the time, all 20 towns. It's since expanded to 21 town. Peru joined probably about 6-8 months ago at this point. And what we heard was that it can't just be a conservation project. There were lots of town concerns about impacts on tax revenues, particularly if there was additional public land that potentially could occur. And so it really shifted the project based on those community concerns. So as I said, we had pretty extensive public outreach in all 20 towns. We had community meetings. I think we actually had two in Charlemont. And as a result of that, one of the other feedback that we got was this really needed to be a private land ownership model, and it needed to be community driven. And the folks had requested that we set up an advisory committee, which we did. So that has representation from 20 of the 21 towns. We also have 8 regional representatives, so we have folks from land trusts, from the environmental community, like the Deerfield River Watershed Association. We have business members, Shelburne Falls Area Business Association, and we also have regional planning organizations. So it was a pretty diverse group of folks. We have foresters, business folks, environmentalists, and they sort of hashed things through. And one of their first tasks was to actually create a plan, which I brought a copy for you tonight. This is the plan itself, and then these are all the mapping products that we did for the 21 communities. And it's also available on the website, and we have extra copies if you need it. But in that plan, probably the two most important pieces is there's a framework of what the new model might look like. So for example, folks were not interested in any federal ownership of land, wanted that off the table. So the way the conservation would work, it would be basically conservation restrictions for forest, working forest would be prioritized. So lands that are already in Chapter 61. But that was really important to folks because they wanted this to be as tax neutral or tax positive as possible, because the other thing we heard from the towns is that they were really struggling with their municipal budgets, and particularly the communities that have state-owned land and that receive pilot payments, payment in lieu of taxes. The pilot payments have been very variable. It's been really hard to budget. They don't get full value, and so that was another problem. So we tried to incorporate all those pieces into what's called the framework that lays out kind of the conditions, and also key project recommendations. So for example, there was a lot of discussion about a visitor center because the Shelburne Falls Area Business Association runs one part-time, volunteers, very difficult to staff. And so folks wanted a visitor center, but they didn't want just a standard visitor center. They wanted a multi-use center so that it would accommodate visitors, but also a research and development component, help out with marketing the region, showcase local wood products, provide public education about all the ecological benefits of forests. So a very broad center. So that was one of the recommendations.
And it would be centrally located, like Charlemont? Or
it would presumably be somewhere along Route 2, because where you would have the most draw for traffic. Or cars that are already traveling on Route 2. It was either, there was discussion about reusing an existing building that was vacant or maybe new construction, but all that is sort of up in the air until we actually get funding.
Does the framework and recommendation include some thoughts on pilots?
No, we really didn't address the payment in lieu of tax piece because we felt that that was outside of the purview of this project since we were really focusing on private land ownership. But what we did do to try and address some of the concerns about, if tourism increased and, for example, there was more emergency response requests or if infrastructure needed to be improved, for recreation, there's what are called municipal cooperative agreements where any of the towns that want to opt in, and I'll get to that in a minute, they basically have a list of eligible activities that they can pick from, and it's proposed right now in the business plan that you got, I think it was $25,000 per year for communities. So you, if you needed like a road infrastructure improvement into a recreational area, you might have to save up. Or if you wanted to go from oil to wood-based heat, you might have to accrue a couple of years and then apply. But maybe there's a smaller project for that amount.
Or it could be used as match for whatever other state. There's good state grants for wood heat, for example, but there's a portion that towns have to pick up. This could be that.
Right. There's funding in there for forest conservation, based on the first cut at the business plan, which I'll go into a little more. It was approximately 2,100 acres. So not a huge amount of forest conservation over the 21 town, but some towns have a lot of land already protected, like Hawley, and are not particularly interested in more land conservation. They're more interested in the economic development piece of the project. And other communities that don't have a whole lot, they might be more interested in conservation. So,
how much land in common?
Not off the top of my head, but it's in here. But I think Conway has lesser amount of land than like a Hawley or Savoy or some of the lands that have big state forests. They have, but you have the wildlife management area,
yes,
right?
We have quite a lot. Yeah.
We have roughly 2,400 acres in state land.
Okay. So what percentage do you recall of that? We had a big map, but I don't know that I brought that with me.
It's about 47-48% total, I think.
That's in permanent protection or within chapter?
And both.
Okay.
And yeah, here's your map right here. It has red is chapter 61. Any kind of green or yellow is permanently protected land.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that'd be like the DCR, fish and game, APRs.
So that's the water protection.
So the red
entire
is,
town.
The red is chapter 61, which is to the landowner where they want to keep it in there.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
So
I think each community is different in terms of what they want to prioritize. We have gotten some feedback that that's not enough money for working forest conservation, but it was sort of a balancing act. So the other piece that we've been working on is the business plan that hopefully you all got copies of. Mm-hmm. The advisory committee members felt it was really important before we went out and started continued discussions with the towns that we have an idea of really how much was this going to cost, what was it going to look like, what sort of were the priorities, if you will. And so there's a summary of the different programmatic priorities in the projects, and then you see that laid out into a first cut budget. That's just a starting point for discussion. Nothing is written in stone. We don't have any funding in place yet. I'll talk a little more about that. But folks felt it was really important to try and lay this out. And one of the other things that people wanted was a partnership that could go on over the long term. Mm-hmm. Too often we get, you know, a grant that helps for 2 or 3 years and then away it goes and seem to be kind of back to square one. So a key component of the business plan is a trust fund. The bulk of the funding, which overall between federal and state resources, we're hoping to get $30 million. The bulk of that, of over 40%, goes into the trust fund. And then that generates enough funding to pay for a very kind of lean staff, the forestry center that I talked about, and some of the other key programs like business programming. There's a revolving loan fund proposed. The idea was, though, that the staffing of the partnership would reach out to existing organizations. So like the Franklin County CDC, hopefully we could look to them to run the revolving loan fund since they already do business loans. These would be geared towards forestry and tourism businesses, but they could do that type of thing. Mm-hmm. And so to really try and coordinate so we weren't duplicating efforts. So we've got the business plan. We actually drafted special legislation that has been sent to Representative Kulik and Representative Mark's office. And as I understand it, it's now with House Counsel that has to review, and they may have some recommendations, and then that will come back to the advisory committee for their review. So where we're at now is really going out and talking with towns about, you know, would they like to support the legislation that's proposed? This is my last visit, actually, in Franklin County. I've visited with 10 towns. We have 8 letters of support. I'm hoping for a couple more, and would love to also have one from Conway. Basically, with the letter of support, and we can provide a sample, you support the legislation that would create the eligible communities, but then there would be an opt-in process. So if you formally wanted to participate in the partnership and gain the benefits, there would have to be either a select board vote or a town meeting vote. And it's really up to the select board whether they feel it should go to town meeting or not. I think most towns are leaning that way. So there's a two-step process that folks wanted because they wanted to see the fine print, so to speak, in the legislation before they committed to speaking.
Sure. So essentially you're looking for agreement in principle at this point?
Yes, okay. For the draft legislation, which I can also send you. And Bob, did you
want to So the add? Legislation basically takes the 13 framework items that the committee came up with after, I don't know, like 10 or 12 meetings over the last year and a half, and more kind of public meetings about the draft plan and so forth. So that Tom Matusko, who is Peggy's counterpart in Berkshire County, took on the task of translating the 13 framework items into a draft piece of legislation, and then there was a subcommittee that reviewed it, and then the whole committee, you know, which usually has like 25 or 30 people there every mm-hmm. time we meet, and they're very critical, I think the committee is, and but they have learned to really work well together, and you know, collectively they have a huge amount of experience, and so I think, you know, they approved the draft legislation that it reflected the framework. But having the two-step process allows you to see if, you know, something happens along the way there. Mm-hmm. But I think this, maybe it started out as kind of like a let's conserve the Berkshires kind of a thing from Boston. And I came from Boston today, so I'll be plead guilty to that.
Welcome to Western Mass.
Yeah, well, I grew up out here, so I'm pretty familiar with the area. I mean, it turned from that into what Peggy said, to economic development using the forests, which the towns out here have a lot of forests, about 80%, the most forested area in the state, the most rural area in the state collectively, and also the poorest area in the state when you add in the rural and forested. There's no other place that has those three characteristics, so it's not the Lennox, you know, part of the Berkshires, it's, you know, the North Adams part of the Berkshires. Mm-hmm. So it's really to help support communities like Conway or Monroe, which has 110 people, and it's really difficult to run a town with 110 people.
Yes, it is.
So one thing I've learned in all the trips, and I've tried to go out to all these meetings, there's probably been about 50 meetings over the last 3 years here, every dollar counts a lot. So if you need $5,000 in Monroe, divide that by 110, it's a lot. So, and that's why, we, you know, being able to hopefully provide $25,000 per town that opts in, you know, in a trust fund that would be permanent, and the money would be invested locally so that the interest coming back that would fund the kind of ongoing program would also kind of do double duty as to helping the local businesses. So there's a lot of really innovative ideas that make up this whole framework, I think, that came from different people in the committee.
Could you say some of those? You know, I mean, I'm trying to think.
So the forest, what,
you know, recreation, hiking, other than that, you know, if we're talking rivers, like, yeah, we see a lot of examples of how people use rivers, but forest, I'm less clear on.
Well, I mean, I think there's the whole forest product industry,
yeah,
you know, that... you know, maybe we haven't done a great job of improving the forest every time we harvest, but if we did over time, you know, a couple of the people said all these ideas sound great, but there's no cohesiveness. Dick and Crane from one of the Berkshire towns, Windsor, said you need to connect the dots. And the connecting the dots is if you have a conservation restriction that's like a working forest. It encourages forestry just like the agriculture easement encourages farming. It's based on that. And you do good forestry, then as the generations go by, the forest products are not like firewood, they're more like veneer, you know. So there's, you know, everything changes over time, but the potential for economic benefits are better through good forestry. So, and doing forestry, you know, kind of reduces the storm damage. We heard that a lot of meetings, that why couldn't we just manage the forest, the state forests especially, but also the private forests, to improve them and clean up the storm damage, which there'll be more and more of as we go through climate change, and improving wildlife habitat. So, you know, one other benefit of this whole partnership is we've gotten a lot of grants in the last couple of years because a lot of partners are all signed on. We got two grants from the USDA that are add up to $1.5 million for landowners to do wildlife harvest and invite the public on to like demonstrate how forestry can be good for wildlife and good for the economy. So the forestry center is different than a visitor center. And you know, it will support recreation, but it also support the forest industry. And there's a lot of opportunities for new products that, you know, we could be on the lead on. And that's the other part of this partnership that is really important, is the Forest Service, which as off the idea of a national forest and onto the idea of a private forest that would support local towns and the forest industry, and the Forest Service would be like the advisor and helper on that. So it really was one of the original ideas of the U.S. Forest Service was to help improve forestry on private lands, but they kind of got off onto the national forest tract, and but they want a model to show how this can be done. And they do have a very large research branch that has a forest products lab with 200 people working at it out in Milwaukee, and they have a state and private forestry branch, and they have a lot of expertise at the national forest that if this became kind of a new entity for the Forest Service that was based on private forests, you still would have all the experts that could come here and help out. So if you had like how do we fix a gravel road, you know, they have forest engineers because they have got a lot of gravel roads, things like that, and innovative technologies that they're inventing out at the Milwaukee Forest Lab. You know, things like they've got a prototype that takes low quality wood instead of like making it into firewood, they can make it into plastics. So, you know, plastics is kind of got a petroleum base to it, which is carbon. Wood has a carbon base also, it's half carbon. So, you know, this could be a place where these kind of technologies could be tested out on a small scale.
And I think that's why they're interested, even though they wouldn't have any land ownership. But they're really they're envisioned as a partner. This 21-town region has three distinct forests because of the variety of topography. So it's sort of an ideal research location for climate change or studying invasive species. So they're pretty excited about that. I think they're most excited about that this was a grassroots, that the communities developed this model, because they don't have a whole lot of experience with that and are excited that the towns are interested in partnering with them. So for
certainly the model that could be applied in a lot of other rural places too.
So this project will allow this partnership to be eligible for more grants, both on the state and federal level.
I mean, the energy, our state energy department is very interested in supporting wood heat if towns or even citizens want to pursue that. So they've kind of set aside some money to study and potentially implement that idea too. So if the state legislation passes, that would be the model for federal legislation. So Peggy mentioned $30 million. We're thinking $6 million, which is 25%. That's kind of a typical match for federal grants. So we would get the match, and then we would go to Washington and say, we got the towns, we want this idea that was invented here, and we have the state saying we'll provide the match. And you know, we've met with the congressional delegation also. Peggy went to Washington to meet with them, and you know, they're excited about this too. It's not easy to pass federal legislation, but in this day and age, having 21 towns and a state like want to work with the federal government in a certain way is a different kind of a model.
So we're hopeful, but no guarantees.
And FERCOG has been active in this. I see FERCOG's name on it.
Peggy and Tom are like the team.
So we've been kind of equal partners with the Berkshire Regional Planning Commission and then the Franklin Land Trust. Wendy is here. Ferris is here from the Franklin Land Trust. They've been a good partner. They actually developed a model conservation restriction that could be used if we got funding. So this is sort of envisioned like the APR program, an APR program for forest landowners.
Right. So under an APR, running the farm business for farming is expected. So, but on most of our easements on forests, it's running a forest business may not be like that. So we don't have a model like that. So this was a huge, there's a lot of little accomplishments which are pretty significant that are in this whole model. So
And one thing I wanted to add about the CR, one of the other things that we heard a number of times when we were out in community meetings is, how are you going to know what's needed in 100 years? And so it's a very flexible CR. If you want to protect it for habitat, if you want to protect it for water, if you want to use it for forest products or even convert some of the forested area to ag land because more food is needed, there's a lot of flexibility built in, and it all depends on the landowner at that point in time what they feel is is best for their forest.
For Boston, I think this is a good model for rural economic development. So that's based on kind of sustainability. So we're not talking about cutting down all the forests. We're talking about managing it to enhance wildlife, to enhance recreation. You know, you talked about like what kind of recreation, but you know, private landowners could develop a trail network on their land that could connect through the state lands, which could make it, you know, quite an attraction for the people who live here as well as people that want
to. Oh, the Appalachian Trail goes through, you know, some private land.
Yeah,
that would be one of my concerns because I know we've had some experience here in town where we had a parcel of land owner get paid to seclude a piece of parcel of land, and he after he got his money, he put postal signs up to keep everybody out. Okay. And that, to me, was not the best way to do
I think that when the government invests in conservation, we usually get some sort of public access.
I mean, that's, I would think so. Yeah.
That's been kind of controversial. I mean, some landowners don't really want public access, or they don't want to be told they have to have public access.
But the person took public funds.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's what one of these federal grants we
keep
have
everybody out.
That Wendy is taking the lead on is we're creating habitat for declining birds through the first grant that we got, $700,000. So gives landowners an incentive to do habitat that will attract birds that are declining. So then the second grant we got, which was the grant was invite the public onto lands where there's demonstrated habitat. Mm-hmm. So we saw that grant and we said, well, that's perfect. We already got the other grant. So then we got $840,000 for that. So that's going to give the landowners a little incentive to open their lands for the public to walk, hunt fish, or you know, just view wildlife on their land.
Yeah.
So it just kind of showed me that when you have like a lot of towns and organizations all working together, it makes it easy to write grants. We worked on a huge HUD grant for climate resilience based on certain disasters. So Hurricane Irene qualified the Deerfield watershed. And it was based kind of on forestry to kind of clean up the storm damage so the next big storm there is, you know, could be cleaned up not through huge investment that may or may not be there, but through the economy, you know. So if there's products that could clean up the forest. We didn't get that grant, but California got $150 million in that grant. And I looked at it, and it was basically the same thing, only instead of Hurricane Irene, it was based on the RIM wildfire, which maybe was a little more
pressing.
Yeah.
Pressing,
but it was basically kind of managing the forest and doing a public service. So just kind of said to me, well, we missed that one, but you know, this idea has a lot of potential, either through the regular funding that we might well get. Mm-hmm. And I think, I don't know of a bill that's had, I think we have about 16 towns already that have sent a letter of support. You know, I think that's it's your best chance by working together, I think.
Sure.
You know.
So what you need from us right now is a letter of support.
For the legislation.
Okay. Yeah. Does anybody
have
any more questions?
For that?
Yes. I can send you the draft legislation and a draft letter of support, and then we really are encouraging towns to customize it, if you will,
sure,
for their viewpoint. So, for example, Holly really wanted to emphasize that their interest was in economic development.
Sure.
Yeah. For example.
Mm-hmm.
So.
All right. I'll make a motion that we provide a letter of support for the Mohawk Trail Woodlands Partnership. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Tom, will you coordinate with Peg and get a copy of that letter, and then we'll customize it.
Awesome.
Yeah, and the draft legislation.
Right.
And the draft legislation.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you,
Bob.
I love hearing.
Thanks for coming in.
Yeah.
Thanks for making the trip.
No problem.
Thank you.
Peggy, good
like,
seeing you.
Good to see you.
Thanks for coming in.
See you again.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Wendy,
you.
Thanks for coming in.
Sure.
Thanks.
Sorry.
Tony, thanks for coming in.
You bet.
It's the nicest ride up Route 116 from 91 to get
we get to take that ride every day.
That's where we're battling the state on running the electric wires right up Route 116.
Oh, they want to do that.
They want to move them out of the woods and cut all the trees down up 116. And we've won that battle so far. Yes, we have.
I hope that's one of the scenic byways.
Well, we consider it that. Well, there's a lot of motorcycle riders.
Really,
yeah. It is a scenic
part.
Yeah.
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 All right. Thank you all.
Thanks, Peggy. Have a good night.
No, it doesn't. As I said, it looks like a butte out of the yeah, I like
that. All right, next item on the agenda is the Emergency Management Multi-Agency Coordinating Center proposal. Tom, do you have something on that?
Yes, this is, sent out some things and gave you hard copies here. This is a program that the FERPUG put together with Homeland Security money, the Western Regional Homeland Security Advisory Council has been getting some money for emergency planning. This is not meant to take over any of the authority over emergency management from towns. It's simply a coordinating center that in the case of a regional problem, like for instance Irene, this would be a way that people could put requests in for equipment or help, and some towns would be the responding town sending equipment and help, but any town that was part of this agreement could request help from whoever else has signed on to it.
Number one reason why this thing got started basically because of Irene.
Yeah. I mean,
everybody was in the same boat all at the same time.
Yep.
And we had no place to go.
Yeah.
Nothing coordinated.
Yeah, this is about coordination of resources.
Yeah. Yeah.
At the last Franklin Regional Council of Governments meeting, Tracy Rogers gave this presentation, and very comprehensive, and unfortunately you can't see too much of it
on these small slides,
but it's a very good presentation and a very good idea.
And I did send that out, so you have the full size version if you want it.
It was right. Funny with that, with the Irene, everybody, because we had no place to go to get everything coordinated, every town struck out on their own to try to get you a little piece of the pie done. Some of us succeeded and some of us didn't.
Yeah. What do they need on this, Tom?
They need it signed. There is a memorandum of understanding in there that...
Right, okay.
And I think there are two copies of it, one for us, one for them.
Right. Any other questions on this? This is just an overseeing, coordinating vehicle for emergencies that affect multiple towns in Franklin County. I'll make a motion that we sign the Memorandum of Understanding for Emergency Management Coordination Services between the Franklin Regional Council of Governments on behalf of the Franklin County Regional Emergency Planning Committee and the town of Conway. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
What this reminds me of is when the hurricane or the tornado went through from Springfield to Worcester and tore up a lot of towns, you know.
Yeah.
Unbelievable damage.
Munson was...
Like what happened to Munson,
incredibly
yeah.
Incredibly hard hit.
Okay, next item on our agenda. The 250th Anniversary Committee.
What?
Ladies.
Both of you have a seat. We don't throw stones.
I came with just little to write.
Little
right.
All
right.
Okay.
How are you?
I'd love to hear your proposal.
All right. So I wanted to come update you on where we're at, talk to you about things that we're seeing that we need permission for or thinking we may need permission for, and wanted to talk with you about logistics on some of that stuff so we can get it in the works because we're a year out. So right now it's a three-day event. It starts on a Friday night, the June 16th. We're thinking it'll start somewhere around 4 or 5 in the evening when people are coming home from work, and it'll go until about 10 that evening. On Friday evening, we're having fireworks around 9 p.m. We have signed a contract with a fireworks company. They came to town and met with Chief Baker, a.k.a. Selectman Baker, and one of our committee members. They took a tour around the center of town, and what they discovered is the best location to shoot them off from is the Rose property. I know that we have lots of people interested in the Rose property in the next year, so hence why we're here to talk about this. what would happen is that field, if we were granted permission to do this, they would light them off in that field. That field will be blocked off from anybody having access to it, as well as Bovio's field on the other side of the river in the cemetery, correct? The cemetery area, I believe, is what they told you. So there's a certain circumference around it that has to be blocked off from anybody.
They literally have to snow fence it, a pretty good side area.
And block the road too?
No.
I'd actually just met with the police chief about this, so he's aware of all of this too. So that's one permission that we're looking for, is to be able to use that field for that purpose on Friday evening. We would also need to find a way to contact all of the residents that are impacted by that in that area. So you would probably be leaning on maybe the administrator or somebody to help us with at least a mailing list, if nothing else,
sure,
to let them know what's going to be happening. So Friday night, what we're looking at right now, and we're not positive it's going to be able to happen, what we wanted to do originally is kind of a block party idea, so less like the festival. We're trying to not have it be like the festival, have it be its own entity.
Distance it.
So the thought was to do a block party in the center of town right here on Main Street, where if we are granted permission from the state, where we might shut down 116 at Academy Hill or Pumpkin Hollow, one or the other, and at Shelburne Falls Road.
Right.
And basically have mobile food vendors that can be down in this area, and people kind of up and down the area and into the ball field, because we'll have it having music going on in the ball field. And then they'd be able to watch the fireworks from that region. We would have grandstand, like bleacher-style seating by the library somewhere that people could sit in and watch the fireworks, because this area is going to be the prime area to watch the fireworks from.
Mm-hmm.
So we're looking, so I reached out to Ken just now upstairs, and he's going to look into whether the state will actually let us shut down 116 for that long a period of time. If not, the alternate plan would be that we could shut down definitely by the library, the two little streets, the two that
sure
connect, yeah, and Academy Hill up to the parking lot, the old barber place. So we could use those, and then the road would still have to stay open if the state won't let us. So that's kind of a question, you know, we're waiting to hear from the state and how you guys feel about that, as to whether we could do it in that manner on Friday. That would just be Friday evening. And then there'll be some plays. We're not really exactly sure when the plays are going to happen, but they're going to happen at various locations in town, whether it be buildings or outside. That'll happen Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Then Saturday is kind of an all-day event, like 9 or 10 in the morning till 10 at night. Pretty much congregated in the center of town, ball field. We're going to leave the roads open. We're going to have a cemetery tour in the old Holland Cemetery over here, where people will kind of be reenacting people who are in the cemetery.
Talking about their lives. Whoa. You'll have someone stand and say, I'm so-and-so from the military, and blah, 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 blah. And
interesting.
Just a few different
people. Notable people in town. We'll have music going on in the ball field throughout all the hours. My question for you guys there is, I've encountered some people who sometimes have issues with noise in that area, and I'm curious what our town bylaw is on how late we can have noise.
Is
that a better term? I don't know.
We'll figure out a way to do that.
Most towns are 10 or 11, so we've set it up right now till 10, and thinking that we're probably staying within the boundaries, I would hope. If we're not, I need to know that so we can adjust.
Well, I think, you know, in lieu of the importance of this event, I'm sure we could make some concessions.
Okay.
Or you can get quiet at 10 o'clock. I mean,
no,
quieter music than
quieter, yeah, exactly.
It's a huge array of music. We've got everything from blues to jazz to country. Some big names coming, and rock and roll.
We have a whole stage and tents being set up.
Nothing really. Real hard.
No, heavy metal.
Heavy metal, that's the word.
Yeah, but I know.
We thought that, because it's a neighborhood.
Yeah, exactly.
Try to do that.
We'll also be looking to utilize the Common in Pumpkin Hollow on Saturday and Sunday. We're going to be bringing in a company who does a Revolutionary War reenactment. So they'd be doing an encampment in Pumpkin Hollow, because that's where the town was incorporated, essentially, or started.
It was the center of town at one point in time.
So we're thinking of using the Common. They would set up their encampment there, they'll cook there, they'll do demonstrations there.
That's right.
We're speaking with one of the neighbors, the Mags, to see if they'll let us shoot off a kind of a makeshift cannon. It's not a real cannon, don't worry. But, you know, reenactment, keyword reenactment. So we'll be putting porta potties down there for them, but they will be camping on that piece of property for the night. We're also looking at having a car tractor engine show, because a lot of people have old cars in this town and tractors and stuff. At this point, we're thinking that will be in the Conway Grammar School because of...
They want to have it the same day of the parade.
They want it the same day, Saturday and Sunday, and we need to be able to park the cars and people to be able to walk around them. So we're thinking we'll do that down along the ball field at the grammar school. And then that also gives us parking out back of the salt shed. So we'd be looking to the town to make sure that that is in a shape where we can park cars, a lot of cars in it. Parking is going to be one of our biggest issues we see right now because we don't have on-street parking in Conway.
Yeah.
So we're hoping to utilize the grammar school out back behind the salt shed. We do have access to a couple of trolleys to shuttle people in and out. We're also looking into some buses to shuttle people in and out. We're also looking at, provided hay season cooperates, preempt it with that, Bovio's Field possibly parking. And I questioned whether we could park in the Rose Field on Saturday and Sunday after the fireworks have ended. Mm-hmm. I don't know
the entrance isn't very good for cars
yet.
Yeah.
So, is
so that's what we're looking at you on is A, can we use it, and B, can we get it improved so that...
Earlier you said that the Bovio's Field would be blocked for the fireworks.
Fireworks so, only, but
so,
Saturday and
so
Sunday.
So Saturday would be okay.
Provided hay season has cooperated.
Yeah, yeah.
Everything well, provided...
We have to deal with the turning that back into agriculture. We'll make sure we don't lose our agricultural status and how that's going to play in.
Well, that has more to do with this year than next year. Mm-hmm. This is the year we need something
planted
and plowed under.
Well, or we just need to make sure it's mowed low, mowed close.
Well, there's so a lot of boulders
there,
too.
Yeah, I mean, so the key would be getting the road a little bit improved to get access for cars down in there, and then telling me where we can and can't park down there. I know that there's some
issues.
River stuff issues. Going on. Yeah. Friends of the Sun or something. I'm trying to remember all these names, sorry, whatever they are. Okay, I was close. Had half of it. And then the other thing we're looking at doing in that field also is called a Teamsters Challenge. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this. It's an old...
So girls are going to go fight.
Yeah, no, not at all.
Just kidding.
Just kidding. So it's an old style of challenge with horses. So they're teams of horses. They get brought in from different areas. People pay money to come do this. Basically, they set up with wagons and stuff, and they have to back them through cones, and they have to go around logs. And it's kind of like an obstacle course, for lack of a better term, I guess. So that, we were wondering if we could do down there, too, as well, but we're not sure about the area. So again, I don't know what's happening with the Rose property, so it's kind of coming to you to find out, like, what's happening down there, and what can we do with it? Because it's a prime real estate for this event.
I don't think anything's going to be done with the Rose property between now and next year when you want to do this.
Okay.
In terms of any development.
Development, okay.
Yeah. We have to plant it with something this coming fall or late summer and plow it under or mow it early in the spring.
That's it.
The only plan.
Can the roadway in be smoothed out a little
bit? We'll look at that, too.
Okay. We can.
I happen to know someone with a bulldozer, if that helps. And he's very good at it.
I happen to know we own some.
One or two.
So maybe we're hoping that the town crew could help out in some ways, like getting stuff like that ready, getting that road, getting the property behind the salt shed kind of spruced up and their equipment maybe shuffled to one side or something, so that we can utilize the bulk of it for parking. We also have a wonderful donation from the French's to use all of their property for parking. Yeah. But
nice. Well,
if the event ends up being the size we think it's going to be, we're going to need all that parking and that's some probably. So we're looking for that. There's going to be other events going on throughout the day, a fireman's muster in the ball field, a chicken barbecue in the ball field, an art show. There's the Historical Society's doing a Lester Stevens art show in the library.
Mm-hmm.
On Sunday, we're going to have a Natural Roots tour down at the Natural Roots Barn facility down there. And then Sunday culminates with the parade. As of right now, we have secured the Shriners to be in the parade with all of their apparatus, all of their vehicles that jump and clowns and the whole shebang, for lack of a better term.
That'll be in the parade on Sunday.
In the parade on Sunday.
They like to be the last one because they say people stay and wait for them.
So I have met with the the police chief to talk about roadblocks on the road. Definitely thinking of still quarantining off this end of Elm Street so we can put bleachers there for people to watch from. We're thinking at this point it's going to start from either the fire station or somewhere north of there and come down to Pumpkin Hollow. It'll end in Pumpkin Hollow so that people can meet with their buses to get back to where they need to go.
And the tractors and the antique cars will be in the parade?
Some of them, not all of them.
And
some,
those will go right to the school.
We'll go right back to the school when they're done.
Yeah, that would be great, yeah.
Yeah. So that's what we're looking at. So parking is one of our biggest issues, so trying to find out what we can do with the rose field and the salt shed. And then insurance is another big question mark I have for you guys. Liability insurance. We are planning on a beer garden for the weekend in the ball field. What that's going to constitute is I've hooked up with the gentleman who lives in town who works at BBC, and he's going to bring in three other breweries along with BBC, so there'll be a variety. What they bring to the table is they bring liability insurance for the purchase of the beer at their table.
Right.
The minute the person steps away from their table, the town has to pick it up.
Right.
Because there's more than one person doing it. So what does that look like? What does that cost? Are we incurring that cost? Is that something the town already has in place?
We'll figure all that out.
Okay. So that was one of my questions there. Is there any other insurance or liability that we need to be concerned with the parade? Being a larger parade than the festival parade is what we're anticipating. With bigger
animals.
Animals, you know, the Shriners, stuff like that. Is there any kind of insurance that we have to worry about there?
We'll talk to our insurance company and we'll figure all that out.
Okay.
You know, obviously other towns do these events.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's got to be a precedent for it.
Okay, and then subsequently also the fireworks. So the fireworks company comes with their own insurance, but does the town need or want to cover themselves in some other manner? Should an amber go somewhere it's not supposed to? Or
I would guess they're covered for all those.
Oh yeah, they are. They absolutely are.
They
absolutely are. I just wanted to voice it to you guys that we wanted to be, you know, concerned.
That's one thing we are with the fire marshal's office and fire department. Everybody has. That's the first thing we look at.
Yeah.
Let's see your insurance. No good. Bye-bye.
Right.
I know that.
We have purchased a banner to go across the road that announces the event that's coming up. It'll be going up in the next month or so.
Event for?
For the main event.
For next year?
For next year. It's a banner that announces that.
So it'll be up for a year?
We're going to put it up now, take it down for winter months, and then put it back up in the spring.
Okay. And where's
ideally, we're looking at it going sort of towards the only two poles on 116 really, with not a lot of wires
fairly line up,
and fairly line up are kind of almost as you are coming to the bottom of Town Hall Hill.
Okay. And you talked to Ken about that?
I mentioned it.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Probably need to talk with the owners of the poles,
Verizon,
too, which would be Verizon.
And from past experience of our bicentennial we had, the 20th anniversary, I mean, you've got to get mass highway approval.
Yep.
And I wish you very good luck on that one. Because when they ran a banner across back then, mass highway came the next day and took it down.
Mm. I had it up in Ashfield, so we're just thinking we might have better luck. We're going to find
maybe
out.
Maybe they changed their... I think they took it down because they weren't asked.
Talk to them first.
Excellent point.
So,
excellent.
You'll have to talk to District 1, I guess, through your staff.
Sure.
You were around for the last celebration?
Yeah.
Maybe.
I didn't realize that, Bob. I thought you were younger than that. You know?
Thanks.
She was a baby. The other thing that we're looking into is, and you may have seen these in other towns, Apple did it, would be the closest town I can think of, are these banners that people can purchase, and they have the logo that we've created for the Sester Centennial. And they can put their name on it, or they could say in loving memory of somebody, so they can put their own little slogan at the bottom, and they get mounted to the flag, like the flags do here on the pole, but they stick straight out from the pole.
Right,
so they'll
right.
decorate the street for the main event.
Oh, great idea.
We're looking at, you know, putting it out there that residents can buy them. So one of the questions was, could we piggyback a mailer onto, like, the next tax bill or something to do that?
That's something you coordinate directly with Jan.
Okay. Great. That's what I needed to know. Exactly. So we're looking at doing something like that. The town hall. What is the ability to use that building?
What do you want to use it for?
Will there be a bathroom?
Will
for
there
men?
Be a bathroom? Or bathrooms?
We have unisex bathrooms
one
now.
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah, we got one woman's bathroom and that's it.
Waiting to hear back from Ken on that.
On the men's room?
Yeah.
Okay. So one was the bathrooms and whether we'd be able to have public access for those or not. Mm-hmm. Two was, I know that right now it's locked upstairs and is being used as a giant storage facility. But we'd love to be able to use that space for an art show. Because the library is being used for a different art show.
I don't think we can. There's no handicap accessibility.
Right. There's no handicap accessibility.
We could use it for storage and things like that because we're going to have
a gazillion
things.
Or at least the downstairs
things.
Room then, I guess.
But the
downstairs room.
We could.
I would recommend rather than opening that building up for bathroom facilities.
No, we're going to have a ton
that
of
you'd have porta potty.
We are.
We're not so sure that that leach field is on the common and could handle all that.
Okay. We already have.
We don't want to have problems with it to start digging that up.
Okay. So we already have a ton of porta potties coming in for the celebration, but we just wanted to ask because it's right there and it's building to be used.
And we think that they're really well placed. We've got them up by Orchard, so when the parade's getting started, they'll be up there. They're going to be all over the place.
Exactly. Did Bob give you a letter that I is a little separate from the 250th? We can come back to it in a minute, but I just saw this. We would love for the Sleckman to be on a float in the parade. Well, we would love for them to enter the beard contest, Speak of the Devil. It's still open until July 9th. I'm looking at one of you to participate at a minimum. It would be nice.
He's already started.
I shave off and start over.
Oh, I don't want
to. We invite you.
We invite you to do it too. Anybody.
You have to start growing a beard as of July 9th. Or goatee, mustache that curls.
Any form of
long sideburns that come over. Any kind of facial.
Dad, you could go back to your burns.
You had a kickoff event for that, didn't you?
We did.
But there was a big fire thing that went off then, and ambulances went, and that was the end of that.
So we got five people signed up. So we'd love to sign some more up, and we would love to have representation from the town. So here we are asking on camera.
I got it in your store.
Next time.
You're already clean shaven.
They have a father-son contest. So.
They have a father-son contest.
And we are asking also for people outside of the community. Anybody could enter.
Right.
Hey.
Exactly. So feel free to enter. Contact us by July 9th if you'd like to enter. We just need a picture of you clean shaven and a $10 entrance fee.
We lowered the price.
Yes, we did. But we are planning on doing a float for you guys, or want to do a float with you guys, or some kind of... So have you in the parade, I guess is what we're getting at. You guys are the people who are running the town right now, so we'd like to have you in towards the front of the parade. We welcome you to either band together, make your own float if you want to get creative, or just say, yes, we'll be in it, and we'll try to figure it out.
We can just march down the middle of the street.
Or you can march.
Keep it simple.
You can try to march, that'd be another way to do it. So let's think about that, what you guys want to do, and we can, by all means, put you in the parade.
You could, if...
Top hat?
I personally think, this is just me, I personally think it's more of a personal touch, I guess, if you're on foot.
Yes.
That's right down the level of the people where you're up on high on a float and stuff like that.
I have walking sticks at home. You each get a walking stick. How's that? Just classy. You know,
the only thing you want to, you probably ought to have a banner made up to tell us who they are.
Do you have one?
Just say to the select board coming.
No, this is as far as it goes.
Okay, all right. So we need to get you a banner. No problem. We got a list of banners already going.
Walking down.
Kids too.
Holding up your.
Wait.
Carry it.
Okay, in front of us.
Okay, you got it. On foot.
Get John an antique car to ride in, so you'd like that.
Well, we do have an old wagon that we're restoring that was in the 50-year-ago thing. No, we're not restoring now? Are we redoing that plan?
I don't know what it's going to be at. You should ride in the old wagon. It's just my personal...
You're worried about it?
Yeah.
It might be painful?
I just think that we should put a piece of equipment in it or something that... be safer. We'll get them on something safer. If they want to ride, we'll get you something safer.
Anybody have an old car?
Segways?
There you go.
Segways.
That's funny.
Right.
Yeah. The new age, right?
Just what we need.
You can join the Shriners then.
Right?
Sure.
Yeah. Absolutely. The Town Highway crew mowing the fields was a question mark. What was that about?
I'm sorry, what?
The Town Highway crew mowing fields.
Yeah, that's taken care of.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that was that one. I think that's what it was from relationship. Well, also, my question for you guys was the downtown area. I know people kind of volunteer to kind of keep up that garden on the common, and so is there a way to wrap something into our contracts for next year where they could do a little more in the center of town, the landscaper, whoever we're hiring?
We'll make sure that that gets done.
Yeah. To dress
is that
up?
The garden club that does that?
I don't know.
We'll coordinate with the
garden club
to do something a little extra on that for next year.
I would love to, I mean, we're willing to help in any way we can. We just think it'd be nice to spruce up the downtown a little bit more. So while we're on the topic of gardens, there's a letter here that was sent to you, or brought to you, not sent to you, because I forgot now. So my other hat, I am a Girl Scout leader in the town of Conway.
Okay.
And
I put it in the mail, because it was a letter. It's in the purple folder.
So if you open that up, you can read that. So I don't speak on their behalf.
Well, you can tell us essentially what they want.
Yeah.
You're not Mass DOT.
I'm not Mass DOT. No, I got a lot of hats, but that's not one.
Just go ahead and tell us essentially what it is.
So the idea is, so I have a Girl Scout troop here. This year they're what's called Junior Girl Scouts. And they can...
That's the letter.
That's the letter from them, yes. They are working towards what's called a Bronze Award. So it's a very high award that they can get, the highest award they can get as Junior Girl Scouts. Yeah. And what they have to do is perform some kind of community service.
How many girls?
I have 7 in the troop. And so they decided, knowing that this celebration was coming up and they were working on a flower badge, that they would like to do a special flower garden for the main celebration. What they'd like to do, they drew you a picture on the blue page behind, is the common at Shelburne Falls Road and 116. On the 116 side of it, would like to dig it up and plant a flower garden that will have flowers in the shape of the word Conway and then 250 coming off the O.
Like that. Has everybody seen this?
Wow, yeah.
I like that idea.
116,
yeah. Excellent.
Down
like excellent.
So they are writing to you to see if you would grant them permission to work on your common, obviously. We obviously would call Dig Safe. They're aware of what that is. We taught them about what that was.
Mm-hmm.
They have been working to raise the funds so they'll have all of the plants donated either via donations or via funds that they've raised themselves.
They can work with the garden club on that. The garden
we actually have helping. Talked with them some on that, and we plan to reach out with them. We reached out to Orchard Equipment, who's offered to help them supply them with shovels and rakes and stuff to do it
That's
with.
Nice.
We've reached out to some local companies who will provide some better soil for that. So the idea here, it will end up being, unfortunately because of the time of year and the research that they've done, it will end up being annuals that get planted there.
Mm-hmm.
But they hope to keep it up for a certain amount of time and then turn it back into grass for you.
Yeah, sounds like a great idea. Great idea.
So that was, they're looking forward to that, if you're okay with it.
Since we're talking a little bit about the sides of the road, there's, when you come around 116 by Orchard, and you make that sharp turn, and you're looking at the school. There's that kind of big area there that's tall grass.
Yep.
Wondering if we could bring that back to a place where people could actually stand on lawn to watch the parade coming down, or maybe photographers stand there to watch the parade coming down. That corner there.
Planted with a bunch of perennials when we did the granite sidewalks, but they've all grown.
We did plant them in, and the first time Mass Highway came back for the roadside mall, they chopped the heads off everything.
So is that Mass Highway property, technically?
A fair portion of that is Mass Highway, and the remainder of it is zoned by the school.
The old school.
Grammar school.
Okay.
There's no town property hanging around.
So can we not touch it?
I would think you have to get permission from Mass Highway.
I mean, I'm willing to wire it over with my John Deere and do it all, but I don't want anybody to
While you're talking about the
banner. Okay.
Oh, do that too. Okay. All right.
Well, does Mass Highway ever object if you mow the roadside?
Right.
I wouldn't think they would.
Would they notice?
They kept mowed down.
Oh, they'd notice.
You think?
Yeah.
But
they've never minded
so again,
the Festival of the Hills signage because they don't get to it. Like right now, it's really high. And
okay, so we'll ask them about that comment.
But the school might care.
The school, well, as long as it's not their property, but just in the front, it's not.
Yeah.
So just making more places for people to stand on.
Yeah,
sure.
Right. And then the last thing I had on my list was there's been discussion of doing a time capsule this time around. Whether it be with the grammar school or with people, town residents. And the question was, is there a location that we could keep it safe for 50 more years here?
A safe location.
I.e. not the basement. Not yes, the basement.
Instead of the vault.
Not the wet basement.
Yeah, the vault.
The vault? Okay.
The vault.
That's not going anywhere fast.
No, not unless the building goes somewhere.
That's right.
Okay. So.
Maybe that is something that you could find something that possibly at the grammar school. There's a building that will be around for many, many, many years to come.
True.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and we, you know, look to you if you have ideas on what might should go into that time capsule.
Certainly mugshots.
Mugshots, of course, yeah.
With your beards and all.
Yeah, with the beard.
See, he agreed. Did you see that? I got him to say yes.
I have one more item.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
Another item, and I forgot to mail it to you when we were talking about things on your list. Someone brought up the idea of putting bricks, you know, with your name on it, mm-hmm. you know, from the bakers, from, you know, whatever, in our garden over here in the park. You know, we could go on the opposite side of the sidewalk. We could maybe put bricks on the side and go around and sell them and do that as mm-hmm. a promotion. I didn't know if anybody had any thoughts about that, whether you thought it was a good idea, bad idea.
I think that's a good idea. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's a good idea. It'd be a lot much less grassy if you don't move there. Okay. Because that would be a permanent thing, correct?
It would be a permanent
yeah.
thing.
Yeah, it would just stay there.
Yeah, it's a great idea. Okay. If you can get people to buy them.
I think we can. It's been
and
very
there are vendors
some.
You can order bricks with.
Yes,
names. Vendors you can order yeah. everything from. Yeah. yes. Unfortunately.
Yeah. yeah.
That's probably more idea. Than we want. okay. I do have one more question. And I should know the answer, but I don't because I don't have the plans. Tents in the ball field. How far down can stakes go in that ball field now?
Oh, this it they should be
should
fine.
Should be no issue if you put up a giant circus tent?
Giant
well,
circus
like,
tent?
Well, like you do
they
for the craft fair.
Guns, right?
Like yeah. the craft fair tent for the festival is pretty huge, and it has spikes that are like, you know.
Yeah.
The only thing we wouldn't want you to do is try to drive spikes into on the tennis court.
No, this yeah, would be so. In the grass area, but.
But we could find that out.
I don't have the plans as part of Parks and Rec.
It's either a foot and a half or 2 feet. A foot and a half might be problematic, but okay. 2 feet would probably be okay. I don't know. We'd have to find out.
Okay.
I think those tent mm-hmm. spikes are like 3 or 4 feet, aren't they?
Well, it depends on the size of the tent. So that the bigger the tent, the bigger the spike. So that's
right.
why I'm questioning, like,
right.
what is the maximum that we can drill down before we hit
yeah,
something.
I'll look
all
at the
drainage.
Plans.
And
yeah,
I'll look at the
I don't
plans.
Think that would, even if you drove them down that far, I don't think it's going
to
affect
them. The other thing I would ask is to find the plan for the electrical. The reason being we're going to be putting tents in that field, and there are now electric lines running from the pole to the first baseline, and I don't know exactly where they run, and even if you call DigSafe, that's private property that probably won't be marked on it. So I'd love to have, if there was an electric plan drawn that I could have,
yeah,
that
sure,
I can get
I'm
a copy
sure
of so that I don't
mm-hmm.
find
should
a
be
line the wrong way.
Sure, yeah, we've got something like that.
Yeah, let's not fly by the seat of our pants on that one.
And I'll call DigSafe, but usually when you get on that far into private property, which even though this is town, you know, it's town property,
yeah.
they don't go that far usually, so I'd be concerned that they won't know where that is.
Well, obviously, you ladies and your committee have done a tremendous amount of work on this.
Getting there.
And things are really shaping up well.
Yes.
This really sounds like a great event.
We really got
really
a lot
good.
Of response to the cookbook, which was really
good. Did you get a recipe from Karen yet?
I did not.
Okay,
excuse
I'm going to go
me,
home tonight, and I'm going to make sure.
Okay.
You got on the phone now saying...
Kate4cats@hotmail.com. It's in the visitor. But...
Okay.
But it's amazing, and then people meet me on the street and they say, I've got another one, are you still putting it in the visitor?
Oh.
So it's really neat. The editing is a killer though, because
okay.
if someone didn't put their, what temperature, it's like, I gotta call you and find out what temperature it's at. Or it's gonna be a great success.
And
you're huge.
You're also looking for a 1 day license.
I'm also looking for a 1 day liquor license for the Chesbro Challenge. So the Chesbro Challenge is happening again this year,
what's
July
9th.
July 9th.
So.
And who's providing the libation this year?
BBC.
Oh, great.
BBC is supplying it with us. We're administering. That's what we're looking for, selling it.
So you need a one-day...
Serving it? Is that
so you one-day license and you need a one-day liability coverage?
I believe it's still covered.
Year. Didn't we do
we
that?
We did not do liability last year. It's covered under BBC, I believe.
Yeah,
so.
BBC has all that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Didn't we have some sort of one?
Because it's restricted. You can only
talked about
you can
it.
Only,
because you can only sell.
Imbibe within their
that's
fair boundaries.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
And we have a tent, right?
We have a tent. Mm.
We have a tent.
I think it cost us $100, whatever we did.
Well, that was for the parking. That was for the parking for the Festival of the Hills.
Oh,
was the extra $100, yeah.
Okay. So we can't do the same bracelet thing for the 250th?
We can. The difference is because you're having more than one vendor. So when we do it this way, BBC is the only vendor. So
yeah,
they carry their liability.
Area.
And
right.
It's a contained
right.
area. There, you drink it inside the tent. On the main event that we're talking about, we'd have four vendors. So who's responsible and whose beer was it?
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to have the ability to walk out of the tent and walk all over
they
town.
They could,
with it.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Did we talk about parking on the street? For the Festival of the Hills, we put no parking on like Elm Street, both sides.
Okay.
For the 250th, we're wondering, especially like for fireworks, and we will be able to utilize the streets as parking.
Well, it sounds like you're going to have to utilize as much as you can get.
Okay.
Right.
So,
but we would have to get permission.
We'll figure all that out.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. You need to put together a parking plan together, I guess, and make sure that Ken will agree to it.
I just met with him before I came down here, so.
And
so we don't get the permission from you. We get the permission from Ken. Who do we get permission from?
I was wondering by Ken first.
Right.
He gives us the recommendation.
The first thing we do.
Okay. I did an hour ago, and he's on board for everything I've talked about so far to you guys about parking. It's just a question of whether we can park
good.
In the fields
good.
Because of hay or not.
Yeah.
Okay. So he didn't see an issue. The only issue we talked about was. During the parade, because of having people like the Shriners in it that have vehicles that jump and stuff,
mm-hmm.
we actually potentially going to have to put up a barricade of some sort along 116 right here, at least in the section where most people sit, to keep, because our kids, our youth that are used to just jumping in the road in Conway during a parade, that can't happen when the Shriners come down through.
Yeah.
So we're going to have to put up some kind of barricade
to
keep people. Kenny's going to have more cops on duty and try to do a little more crowd
sure.
control for something like that. So he's
less
on board.
Candy.
Hmm?
Less candy.
No candy. No candy driving.
What your
parade.
Group needs to do is, and that should be done at least 30 days in advance, maybe even 45. You need to get together with all the emergency services in county. Come and help.
I already reached out to him.
Come out. Everybody sit down in the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And come together with an emergency plan for
mm-hmm.
for that weekend.
Yeah.
She needs to be someone to keep on telling. So you know if something happens, what's going to take place.
So I reached out to Gemma Hill.
I think it's good
to help.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Gemma.
And mm-hmm. Chris, who's going to reach out to you anyway. So
mm-hmm.
So we'll get together. And I met with Ken just now.
It don't need to be done.
No, but
now,
I want to have the preliminary conversation now so that we know if there's anything
yeah.
that just can't
right.
happen.
Stations,
mm-hmm.
you know, different
yeah.
places that can go right in
yeah.
and rescue someone.
Okay.
Do you have any anticipation, and it's a crazy question to ask you, how many people you think are going to be in town the day of the parade?
No.
We think the parade might be as long as almost 2 hours. It's a very big parade.
Do you think a lot of people
bands,
from out of town will come?
The bands, yeah. like from
Holyoke
High
School. We're
going
to be promoting
school,
and marketing
right,
it to
right.
out of
all
town.
The area high schools,
via newspaper,
mm-hmm.
radio, publicity, all different avenues of publicity. So we're hoping to bring a lot of people in. One of our members of the parade committee is looking into bringing the Mummers in, which they'll help promote it on their end. Shriners will help promote it on their end.
So this could be
so
a lot bigger than the Festival of the Hills.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh,
yes.
This is
the
Festival
okay.
of the Hills is
yeah.
this big.
I can
the other
you,
one's
I
this
see.
Big.
50
yeah.
years
the only
ago,
concern
there was probably 10,000 people.
And
right.
I can have,
yeah.
I can
yeah.
have because I was there when we had our last 200. We literally had a sea of people. I
uh-huh.
mean, a sea of people.
Well, we're thinking also.
They were just
everywhere.
We're thinking of a grandstand.
20, 30 deep on every side of the road, every corner, nick, cranny you could think of, was just covered with people.
Huh.
You know where the greens
I don't know
are
if it'll be that,
up at
but
OESCO? We're thinking
mm-hmm.
of maybe
somewhere
putting some bleachers
two.
There, so people coming down won't have to come into town, and they can go right up and park
mm-hmm.
up on
yeah.
Ives Road, French
mm-hmm.
property, and then sit
I
there.
I think there's a consensus now that there's probably not that many people come out of the parade like there was back 50 years ago.
Yeah.
It was the event back then. That's what there was to do.
Yes,
now there's a lot more to do in the world. So I don't think that you're probably going to see that $10,000 people like you saw 50 years ago, but I think you'll see more than the couple of thousand that you see at
the
festival.
Five, six, seven.
Yeah. So I think somewhere in the middle is what we're going to see.
Right.
It will gridlock this town.
So that is a real parking issue.
It's a parking nightmare.
Yeah.
It is.
Hence why we're bringing in a couple of trolleys that come with drivers from the Amherst Bid District.
Mm-hmm.
we're looking at buses.
Right.
We're trying to stay away from like the hay wagon kind of thing because I know that's a liability nightmare.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we're trying to do actual bona fide transportation.
Right. Good idea.
Good idea.
Okay. Has anybody volunteered? You know, Howard volunteered to park on his property?
No, none of the farmers are. It's Hayes.
It's Hayes.
I know it is.
So we can't. So we're that's why we're utilizing property like the French's, Bovio's, if it's mowed, hoping for the Rose property when the fireworks aren't going on, because that's a big chunk of land that we can actually do something with, hopefully.
Yeah.
You know, and then there'll be street parking to some degree, you know, down Pumpkin Hollow and stuff.
And
like
you're going to do a lot of parking down to Grammar School, you said, right?
Down to Grammar School, right.
How about on Parsons Hill, that part in the middle, is that a hay field that gets hayed or...?
There are multiple owners of that. I spoke to one of them, and he was going to discuss it with the others, but it is one that gets hayed. So, again, it'll be dependent upon the year we have.
But if it could be cut right before the
event, then great.
And
that's what all the other farmers we've talked to have said, is like, if we had an early spring like this year and we can cut early, by all means, we might be able to let you on it.
Of course, things what happens with weather in the weekend, too. It makes a big difference how many people show up.
Yep, that too.
Yeah.
One of the other events, which we forgot to mention, is that... Ron Boyden has suggested that he'd be okay with people coming and paying a quarter to milk a cow.
Oh,
okay.
Is
milk
that cool?
A cow.
Milk a cow.
Have you ever milked a cow?
What?
Have you ever milked a cow?
No. And I don't think I will either.
Oh, come on. It'd be a great like, headline.
Certain things I
Chairman
just don't
milks
want
cow.
To
do.
I don't know if it's a quarter or a buck, whatever.
It's not that hard, John.
It's so much fun.
I'll spot you.
Oh, I'm sure I can do it. It's just whether I want
to
do it.
You have to get close to the cow, though. You have to get very close.
Very close to the cow. Yes.
Lots of old-fashioned kids games.
Exactly. So yeah. So you know, just as long as we have permission to be on all of the properties that we mentioned, and you can let us know about the Rose property, what we can and cannot do down there.
Okay.
That's kind of
the event sounds really doable. You know, the way you've laid it out.
They put a ton of work into it.
Yeah.
And I'm sure I speak for the whole board. We'll give you all the support we can.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much, all. Thank
you. So you're all going to make an appearance at Chesbrough Challenge then?
I can't be there.
To the BBC tent.
Fine. It's at the event.
Go.
It's at the event. That's all I ask.
We do have a cherry spitting contest.
See, when I get into competing events, I like to compete real hard. It's my body that doesn't. You know.
So you can compete real hard in the beer tent.
Well, I know.
See how that works out.
I don't want to do that.
Egg toss.
Egg toss.
Hey.
Tug of war. Cherry spitting contest.
We'll see.
Exactly.
We'll see. Okay.
Cool.
All right, I'm going to make a motion that we approve the one-day beer and wine license for the 250th anniversary committee
for the Chesbrough Challenge.
Town ball field for the Chesbrough Challenge.
Yeah.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Any opposed? There's some mistakes there. So, also, I'll make a motion that we support the proposal of Girl Scout Troop 11817 for the 250th anniversary celebration for their plantings on our town common on Shelburne Falls Road and 116. Do I have a second?
Second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Great, thanks.
Would you give a copy of that to Tom? You know.
I went home, so we're good. Wow.
That was fast.
And for the license, if you can actually give that to me, it comes in two, and we can just give them their half now.
Good idea.
Good evening.
Should we have signed it twice?
With the, what's that?
Do we have to sign it twice for that?
No.
Okay.
We keep the application for it, and they get the license for it. This is the fancy way of doing it.
Ladies, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you.
Sounds like a great event.
Yeah.
You guys are doing a great job.
Thank you.
Go, ma'am. See you at Chesbro, or not.
Thanks, guys.
Bye-bye.
Next item on our agenda is the Energy Committee request to hang a solarized banner on Town Hall. What do we got, Bryce?
Things are going well.
Good.
Over the next first couple of weeks in July, we're going to be having a Meet the Installers meetings. One scheduled for Conway will be on the 13th. And as part of the program, the Mass CEC has supplied each of the towns with a banner. And what I'd like to do is I was going to plan on making a frame for it and then to hang it on the town hall for a number of weeks. And then I was thinking of moving it, if I could, maybe to upstairs.
Okay. Anybody have any questions on that? Okay. Coordinate.
You'll take it down for winter.
You're what's that in?
So we're going to be done. This will be done.
This will be done in a matter of weeks.
The sign-up goes through September 30th. And then, and they're already, and since they've provided us with the lowest rate possible from the beginning, they'll be able to start installing right away. So it's still going to be about a year out for everybody to get them all done. But this will be really helpful. Coleraine got one that stretches across, you know, on the street banners, and they have it, as you know, in the center of Coleraine, where you've got all the churches, got one in one of them.
Okay.
So everyone will see this. And I was thinking to put it on the town hall on the side, so as people are driving down or going up, they might see it.
On the 116 side of the town hall.
Yes.
Yeah, good. Coordinate with Tom on that. Mm-hmm. I'll make a motion that we give the Energy Committee permission to hang their solarized banner on town hall initially, and then where do you want to do it after that?
Upstairs.
Move it upstairs here, yeah. In the town offices.
Great.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Bryce.
Thank you very much.
How many people have signed up now?
Thanks for coming in, Bryce.
It's very interesting seeing the meeting tonight, seeing how the town works. You guys are doing a tough job. We have over 200 people in the three towns have elicited interest.
That's
and
great.
And we're starting to do the assessments, of which it depends on where they're located, whether they're going to have a decent view, sun view, and also we have a lot of slate roofs,
right.
Which also adds a complication.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we're shooting for a total of 150 installations by the time we're done. Thank you very much.
Great.
For this.
Great.
Take care.
Thank you, Bryce.
Yep.
Have a good night.
Will do.
Okay, next item on the agenda is to sign employee stipend forms. We have done that with the warrants, so I'll just make a motion to make it official to sign the employee stipend forms. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay, the next item is to approve the revised injured on duty quote. Bob, you had given Tom some updated information.
Yep. Yep.
And that has also already been signed, but to make it official, I'll make a motion that we sign the approve the revised injured on duty quote.
Second.
You have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Consider the treasurer's request for policy change to bring town policy into alignment with state law. Tom, is that a separate issue, or is that under the revised?
That is a separate thing. Sorry
separate
for the.
Wasn't this done last year?
The extra thing.
Did we vote this last year?
I think we did. We don't know about it. So
that's retirees' health insurance, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You send out a note about that. Yeah.
Yeah. It's
yeah, we
maybe it was just to have the insurance in general for the whole town.
What's in our policy is for retirees is something that is not in accordance with state law, as shown by a recent court case in the town of Irving.
Right. Right. Okay. So we're just coming into compliance.
So
with
things
the law
like a 10-year requirement, things like that, they're all gone.
That's not. Yeah. So and the second page has the final version.
Right? Yeah. I'll make a motion that we approve the change in retiree health insurance to come into compliance with the law. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Should I be signing this? Seeing I'm a retired health insurance recipient?
I think it's fine.
Yeah, it's there's no conflict there.
No.
Approved participation in regional sign making program.
The Franklin Regional Council of Governments has bought some equipment so that any town that wants to be part of the program can learn to operate the equipment and make our own signs.
Signs such as what?
Highway signs.
Slow
street
children.
Signs?
Yeah, street signs.
You mean like name, street name signs? Or
no,
just
like slow children. Go slow
traffic
children.
Traffic signs.
Yeah. Probably most of the yellow ones.
Did you get this?
Yeah. And you know, it's of most benefit to the towns that have the most signs or put the most signs up, but there's no cost to it just to join. So and Ron looked at it and said it looked fine to him.
So he'd be trained in how to do this?
Yeah.
We saw a presentation of it at the Franklin Regional Council of Governments meeting. Looks very good. It's economical, it's fast. I'm sure it'll be helpful.
Good.
And it's being kept at the town of Greenfield DPU.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where we'd go to get things done. So I'll make a motion that we approve the joining of the Regional Highway Sign Making Program. If I have a second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay, next is recognition of past select board member town resident. We don't want to say too much about that at this point, but we're going to do an appropriate recognition for that.
Great. Okay. It'll be a very modest expense.
Mm-hmm. And I'll just make a motion for that. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay. All right, next item, we have appointments. I'm going to read these names. I think we've done some of this so far. I'm going to read that. Regional appointments through June 30th, 2017. The Franklin County Inspection Program representative is Tom Hutchison. Sign Making Program Advisory Council rep is Ron Sweet. The Franklin County Emergency Dispatch representative is Robert Baker. Ken Wemet and Gemmer Vanderheld. Staff appointments through June 30th, 2017. Animal Control Officer Joseph Colucci. Board of Assessors Clerk Laura Dove. Board of Registrars Virginia Knowlton. Election workers, Winona Coors, Deborah Craven, Phyllis Darcy, Laura Hannis, Dorothy Harris, Danielle Lockhead, John Lockhead, Sydney Ramey, Catherine Whitcomb, and Natalie Whitcomb. Custodian, Deborah Craven. Highway Department, Ronald Sweet, Bradley Wallace, Adam Baker, Jason Stone, Nicholas Sweet, substitute Randall Williams. Transfer station attendants, James Allen, Leland Gray, Paul Lloyd, Leroy Rose, James Wakefield. Assistant to the town administrator, Elizabeth Jacobson Carroll. Treasurer collector, Jan Warner. Assistant treasurer collector, Lynn Kane. Veterans grave officer, Leroy Rose. Okay, public safety staff through June 30th, 2017. The ambulance department director is Gemma Vanderheld. Assistant director, Christopher Herman. Clerk is Jesse Sobek Rosnick. EMTs, Robert Armstrong. Is that Robert Armstrong Jr.?
No, but it's my son.
Okay, Robert Armstrong. Adam Baker, Robert Benson, Conan Pelk, Jesse Sobek Rosnick, Alexandra Williams, Randall Williams. Emergency Management Director, David Chichester. Enhanced 911 Coordinator, Robert Baker. Fire Department Chief, Robert Baker. Captain, Christopher Herman.
John, we got a little bit of clarity. The captains are Christopher Herman and Matt Boyden.
Christopher Herman and Matt Boyden. Okay. Deputy Chief Adam Baker, Deputy Chief and Deputy Warden Ronald Hawks, Lieutenant Joseph Parama, Clerk Laura Dove, Firefighters we have Robert Armstrong, Helen Baker, Daniel Blakesley, Howard Boyden, Willis Burnett, Colin Burt, John Conant II, Deborah Craven, Doug Dean, Amanda Dunnell, Christine Lankarge, Conan Pelk, Thomas Romanowitz, Stephen Scala, Jesse Sobek Rosnick, Matthew Sweet, Gemma Vanderheld, Nicholas Vanderheld. Junior firefighters, Trevor Baudet, Alexis Dean, Dakota Dean, Michael O'Connell, Brooke Romanowitz, Fisher Talbert Hills, and Olivia Vicelio. Police department, we have the chief, Ken Wimet, reserve officers, Donald Bates, James Bernier, Christina Conklin, Ronald Hawks, Nathan Jackman, David Johnson, Charles Wilder, and Randall Williams. I'll make a motion that we accept those appointments. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right, items not anticipated in 48 hours.
One point of discussion about that I wanted to get in actually before you made the motion. I've had a communication from David Chichester that he is planning to leave town sometime over the course of the next year. So we will be looking for another emergency management director at that point.
Okay.
That's some news to us. At least they'll make our be the voice for our phone calls.
That would be an honor.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. We have a resignation from the Historical Commission from Mary Miriam, and we have a recommendation that is unanimous from the Historical Commission to appoint Willis Burnett to Mary's seat for a 3-year term beginning in July July 1, 2016, and running through June 2019. I'll make a motion that we approve the recommendation of the Historical Commission and appoint Bill Burnett to the position that's been vacated by Mary Miriam for a period of 3 years from July 1, 2016 through June 30th, 2019. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Concerns of the selectmen. Do we have any concerns of the selectmen?
I do have one.
Okay.
I don't know whether we have to deal with this or we should try to get the garden club to deal with our common down here that the Christmas tree is on. When they was designed, they put these three small bushes around the outside of the Christmas tree. They've now grown so big and mammoth that I myself have almost been hit by cars coming down off of 116 because you can't see them. And I've seen several other people almost getting crashes in the last couple months there. So I think we need to either have those eliminated or talk to the garden club, have them trimmed way down if that's at all possible. But right now it's a very safety hazard.
Okay. Tom, would you address that with the garden club, please?
Mm-hmm. You mentioned it out there, look, Tom, you'll see what I mean. It's impossible to see it around the common now.
So when you come out, stop at the end of the road by the library, you can't go to the right?
The worst is going this way and turn to go down on Elm Street.
Oh, I see, yeah.
When you go, because people come flying down the hill and turn on Elm Street.
Yeah.
Without even touching their brakes sometimes.
Yeah.
And man, you can go and get broadsided there because you can't see them coming. Especially during the day.
Okay.
That's the only concern I got, John.
Thank you both. I think we've got all our mail covered except for...
I have some brief updates as well.
Oh, the administrator update.
I beg your pardon, Tom. I skipped you on the agenda.
All right, I don't have much. I'm sure you've noticed the new desk arrangement in this office. The L-shaped desk that was here is now Ron's upstairs, and his desk is being readied for double duty for the emergency management director and the highway clerk. Regarding the highway clerk, a notice will be included in the upcoming visitor, and we hope to have several applicants. Roy Cohen has been working with Dave Chichester on a revised web portal for signing up for emergency notifications, which is now on the website and functioning.
That's great.
It looks as though we will not need to make any end-of-year transfers between departments. Nonetheless, please note that we have until July 15th to correct any deficiencies in departmental budgets, including one more round of FY16 invoices on July 11th.
Mm-hmm.
And departments have all been notified that they need to encumber forms, encumber funds if they have outstanding bills.
Right.
We also all got an email, I'm not sure whether you all read it yet, from Janet Shays, the mm-hmm. Open Space Committee, inviting us to tour the invasive plants on the Rose Field this Wednesday at 6 p.m., so coming right up. And there's a little bit more on that, but that's the basics.
So I can put in a pitch for that. She sponsored getting Lori Sanders out here to do this tour 6 months ago, and it was fabulous. I don't know if you know who Lori is, but she's a naturalist. She used to have a program on I think it was Channel 2 in Boston, and she may be out here. She's really knowledgeable. So she's going to do this tour.
How long do you think the tour is going to take? Did it give you any indication?
No idea. I'd say an hour. Anyway.
Probably took an hour, hour and a half. Yeah. It was excellent.
Thank you, Tom. In the mail, we have a letter from Mass DOT, Western Turnpike, State of Good Repair Findings letter.
Which said that it is not in good repair, and therefore they're going to keep the tolls in Western Mass.
Big surprise. Right.
Say that again, they're going to keep the tolls in Western Mass?
Because it's not in good repair.
Yeah, so they need
to... What do they call Western Mass now? Springfield West?
Yeah, Springfield West, I guess.
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah, they have some improvements they need to make.
Okay.
Okay, any announcements? No announcements. Okay. Next meeting?
Just the upcoming Franklin County Select Board Association meeting.
Oh, right. And, sorry.
And that's Thursday.
That's
it's on
Thursday
Roads
night.
And Bridges, which is big. I will be on vacation, but there should be some things there. And then the that was just the same thing about Laurie Sanders as the Rose Field item there.
Right. Okay. Next meeting is Monday, July 11th at 7 o'clock here in the town offices. Let's see. Okay. No more business to come before the board. I'll make a motion that we adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay.
Aye.
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 Mm-hmm.